Sonny wanted to go. I said, Sonny, you going to get dressed up? He's like, no. I was like, why not? He goes, I couldn't get my outfit in time. I said, who are you going to go as? He goes, Cliff Booth. I go, Cliff Booth?
Oh, from Once Upon a Time in Hollywood.
Yeah, he wanted to go.
Yeah, I'm like, where do I know that name?
He wanted to go as Brad Pitt's character, the guy who killed his wife with a
right
with a spear gun on a boat.
Foreboding.
Yeah, foreboding. And that's where he killed her on a
Booth
boat.
Powers.
I didn't know
what kind of costume.
What kind of kid would go?
Powers Booth.
What kind of kid would go as Cliff Booth?
That's weird.
And he's like, I couldn't get the outfit. I'm like, well, what outfit? You need a T-shirt.
Hawaiian shirt, wife beater, jeans.
What do you need? Vans? I don't know. What do you need? So he said, ah, screw it. So my daughter and her friends.
Some aviators.
My daughter and her friends were like, we want to go TPing. I'm like, okay, how does that work? Like, what is my culpability? Like, how does it work for me as a parent? You know what I mean? To aid and abet this illegal behavior. And we got TP'd the night before. So
our
house got TP'd. So we had to come back. We had to come back. And I said, okay, let's, how are we going to do this? Anyway, put 8 kids in my car, went to Ralph's, bought a bunch of toilet paper.
You were allowed to buy a bunch of toilet paper? It wasn't limit 1 per customer?
I guess they've lifted the embargo. I'm so weird. I'm like, do the single ply. Don't get the quilted stuff. Don't waste the quilted stuff.
That's right.
So they go in.
Get the Kroger brand.
Yeah. Right. They buy the toilet paper. We jump in the car. Then I do this thing where I'm like, all right, listen. If the fuzz pops us, we can't use our real name. So I start handing out handles to everybody. I'm like, look, I'm Falcon. Natalia Snowman, you're TJ, you're Hondo, you're Dutch, you're Murdoch, you're Rambo. Like, I was just giving out these stupid names of these kids. I was really just naming the cast of the TV show SWAT.
Yeah. Oh,
nice. I took SWAT and the A-Team, and I combined all the different characters in that.
You should give one girl a name, Beth.
Yeah, I should have had an outlier. So, I give them all their handle. We go out. We TP some poor person's house.
Were you involved or were you just the getaway driver?
He's the wheel man.
I told him I was the wheel man, in and out in 4 minutes. I was wheels up in 4.
You'll leave without him.
That's what I told him. I was talking
about.
Your
alarm's been tripped.
I'm like, look, I need a good second story man. They're like, it's a single story house. I'm like, don't argue with me. So, I was the wheel man. And I waited outside, TP'd the house. Then they all jumped in the car, cackling and giggling, and we drove off. Then we decided we needed to TP someone else's house.
We decided.
So they decided we needed to TP someone else's house. So we went and TP'd the house. And there was actually one kid we were going to TP. And then as we were going to that person's house, Natalia called an audible. And like, it was kind of like in Goodfellas where they were going to kill, what's his name?
Maury. Maury's wigs.
She just said, not tonight. Not tonight. Ooh, we just drove.
The things that happened.
They don't know how close they came to getting TP'd. But we went to another house. And then we TP'd that house. And then we laughed like hyenas and we drove home. And then when we got home, they went out and ran around, went to McDonald's or whatever. And about 10 o'clock that night, I heard a little noise outside. And lo and behold, it was retaliation time. We were getting a second round of TPing. And I walked out the front door, and there was about 8 kids out there. And I got to use the dad voice. I walked out onto that porch, the streets down below, and I was kind of high. And they were like laughing, and they were laughing. And I go, hey, get out of here. And they just
go on, get.
They
scattered.
Right. 6 out of the 8 took off. The other 2 just stood there. And then I gave them the follow-up. I said, beat it. And they all just ran.
Those 2 are the ones you got to watch out for later.
That's right. Were you trying at all to be funny or were you trying to be scary?
I was going novelty, over-the-top, angry dad voice that I don't
think. What that means to you is totally up.
Yeah. I don't think they were going to get the irony in it. But anyway, they scattered. Our house gets nailed. And
we
get destroyed. And then the next day, Natalia's friends, not Natalia, start they clean up a little bit that night. Now they're bringing up toilet paper rolls that are almost full, and then they're bringing up a big bushel of toilet paper. And I'm like, I'm not throwing this away.
No.
My goggles pops out of the bushes.
Yes.
I get with a duffel bag.
Yeah.
Yes. He's like Wimpy from Popeye. Did somebody say toilet paper?
I'll pay you Tuesday. I want to roll on Monday.
I will gladly pay you. So I take the big bushel of toilet paper. I just put on the counter. I'm like, I'm not throwing this stuff away. This stuff's got some value. It's got pine needles in it, but I'll work it out.
Zap.
So the next morning, a nice young girl shows up unannounced, and we just spot her out of the window. She's just cleaning. She's just cleaning the toilet paper. She's out on the street. She's pulling it all up. And I say, who is that? Natalia goes, well, that's the girl's house who we hit. And I said, well, what's she doing at our house? Well, she's cleaning it up.
Wow.
And I was like, wow, that is that kid's a crackerjack. That kid's a crackerjack. And it's like, so I was thinking about it. I said, so wait a minute. We nailed her last night. She's like, yeah. Then they came over and nailed us after that. She said, yeah. I said, now she's coming over the next morning to clean up? Yeah. I said, did we clean up her house? Natalia's like, definitely not.
Did we?
Yeah, we. I don't remember going over to her house. She said, no. I said, that's incredible. So then Natalia goes, why don't we give her $20? And I said, you're right.
Wow.
We should give her $20 because she deserves a reward for this. So I look at my drawer. I have the only cash I have is a $100 bill.
Oh, no.
Yeah, change.
So I go.
What's your Venmo?
I don't have $20. 100 sounds like a lot. But you know what? This chick should be rewarded. She came back the following day to clean up, not unannounced. I think she just thought she was going to come out to the street and kind of quietly, without much fanfare, just clean up the front of my house and then leave. So I said, you know what, Natalia? Give her $100. Here's $100.
Wow.
So Natalia goes down there.
Damn.
To give her $100. And this girl's like, no, I won't accept it. And then they start having this argument out in the street. Like, Natalia's like, take the $100. And she's like, I will not take the $100. And at some point, Natalia's like chasing her around, trying to give her the $100. Now it's turned into a joke.
Trying to pin it on her.
Yes. She wants none of it. She comes over, cleans the place up, refuses to take the $100, and goes home. And I thought to myself, I'd like to hire that person in 10 years. Like that person has character. That person has something that most people don't have. And I don't think any of this stuff exists in a vacuum or bubble. I think that's that person's character. I could see that person doing versions of that many, many times throughout their life. Right. I mean, it's going to have to do with friends or homeless people or donating or whatever that thing is that they're going to do later in life. That will be that person.
It's not TP only. Yeah.
No, it's not. It's right. It's not exclusive to toilet paper. Yeah.
And I thought
that's a good character move right there. So
Will you call her parents and say, like, she's awesome? Like, would you let them know? Like, it's like speaking to the manager for good customer service.
Oh, yeah. A commendation or something.
Yeah.
I should. But I was the wheel man for their paper.
You know where you live,
sir. Right. So that.
You know, I pull at that thread.
That's a little tough. And they should, although, I mean, I should. On the other hand, they definitely know who she is, right? I bet I bet they understand very well who that young lady is these days. All right, so
you're reminding me of my high school job. I've mentioned it before. Obviously, I was a grocery store bagger. I did that for 2 years, and the store was a small private, like a Bristol Farms kind of thing. There were like five locations, family owned. The guy's name on the wall, the whole thing. And the policy was we were not allowed to accept tips. Mm-hmm. And for a 16-year-old making whatever it was, $6.75 an hour, that was devastating. Like, people would be like, oh, here, kind of helped ladies out to their car for the, with the groceries, right? The whole thing. And like, oh, here's $5. And I'm like, I can't take that. I'm sorry. Thank you very much. The only time I ever took a tip was this brassy broad stuffed it in my apron. She's like, oh, shut up. Just take it. I'm like, all right. Well, I can't do anything about that.
By the way, I don't know. Why is that a policy?
My only guess is that the guy who owned the place, Alfredo Lenardi, was a very old school Italian immigrant, racist and bossy. And he was the boss, you know. And I think that he just settled on a policy. Maybe that's how it was in his day, like in the 50s. Mm-hmm. This is 1996, whatever it was. So I'm guessing maybe that's how it was in his day, and he's going to pass that along. That was my
only
logical.
He'd only accept tips from white people?
No, he made disparaging comments about why there were coincidentally no black people hired to work at the store. And Alfredo, I
had thoughts about it.
Slept once that he had thoughts.
So I'm sorry. Was there a story?
No. It just reminded me of the fact, you know, not taking the money. I wasn't allowed to take tips, and it was devastating, especially to a kid that's in mid-teens.
I worked delivering. I worked at a liquor store where you were allowed to take tips, and I never got one. I delivered booze and never got a tip to people's houses.
That feels like the ultimate time you don't want to leave a tip.
Well,
someone brought booze to your house.
The problem with my job, which was like, I've really like my early life, like 0 to 30, I was cursed. I literally was cursed. Like, I never had a fun job. I never had a good job. I never had a tipping job. You know, you can be poor and you can have shitty parents and you can come from the wrong side of the tracks, but you can also have a job. Like, people have jobs where they go, I used to work at a putt-putt golf place, and after they would close, we would go to the batting cages and we'd fire up the grill and we'd have a good time or whatever. There's versions of, you know, I was poor, but XYZ. My uncle, he owned a deli, and we used to be able to work there, and we'd make ourselves sandwiches. Like, there's poor versions of kind of, oh, but you had this cool perky thing or something, worked as a lifeguard down by the shore, whatever, cute chicks or some version of the poor thing. I was just fucking snake bit my entire life. I got a job when I worked for the Flask Liquor Store, still there on Ventura Boulevard. I delivered booze everywhere around Studio City and Los Angeles and Beverly Hills and everything else. I never delivered one bottle of booze. If you deliver one bottle of booze to someone's house and you hand them the booze, you will get a tip.
Right.
I delivered boxes and cases of booze
for weddings or events or whatever.
Events, weddings. Some people, rich people, just have their shit stocked. You know what I mean? Like, bring it down to the pool cabana and put some Schweppes down there and whatever. Yes, weddings and whatever. Also, production companies, like on the lot. Mm-hmm. Bring it on the lot. You can eat. So I would deliver 6 cases of Diet Coke to the production company and just I used a hand truck and schlep it in and go up the stairs and put it in the kitchen and do all that. The only person there was the receptionist. They would never get a tip. Or I'd go to the rich guy's house in Beverly Hills and I'd put it down by the pool house and I'd put the other stuff in the kitchen. Nobody was home.
Yeah,
it was
like see them.
The maid would let me in.
Right.
She didn't tip me. So I would ironically deliver multiple bottles of booze and cases of booze and schlep it all over the people's house and all over the production and whatever, or weddings and all that. Never got a tip. There was nobody there. So it was just kind of I went from McDonald's to that to ditch digging. Not a lot of tips and ditch digging, but yeah. So wait a minute. Gina, you want to talk about what you did for Halloween? And Brian, you can tell us as well.
Sure.
I should tell you guys, the kids were pretty good because they were like, we're going to go TPing the house when we're on the way to the supermarket. And I said, are we going to do any egging? And they're like, no, too mean.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
That's pretty
so, they have a Geneva Convention. So no flaming dog shit. That's out of the question.
No.
All right. Okay. Well, that's nice.
Yeah.
So the schedules and the holiday schedules are weird when you have 50-50 custody. So this year we only got him for an hour and a half and we didn't get to pick what time. And it's just, it's the worst. So we had to pick him up in Beverly Hills where there were riots and protests and street closures. And it was illegal to trick or treat. If they saw you going house to house, you would get a ticket.
Yeah, so we had, there is one street, I think in my neighborhood, which is the big trick-or-treater street where they do, like some houses have the Christmas light street or whatever. There's a big trick-or-treater street. And they literally moved one of those big rolling signs that said like street closed, like they would put out on the highway. Awful. They literally, there's cop cars.
Yeah.
Sitting there saying
like
the street
trap.
Is closed. Yeah.
Right.
A sweet trap.
That's right.
So, you know, Andy is so creative. And I like to think I get him in every once in a while. But he is so creative when it comes to this stuff. And I had a friend who was having a little candy hunt in the front yard. But, of course, you know, we couldn't, for some reason, she just could see herself agreeing to that. So we said, okay, fine, whatever. So they were dressed, the little one and Andy were dressed like Mario and Luigi because the kid is obsessed with Super Mario Brothers right now, as all little boys eventually are. I was dressed as Princess Peach. I think you guys have seen that costume before. Mm-hmm. And so we broke into a playground in Beverly Hills in the middle of the night. Andy got a bunch of boxes for like mailboxes, et cetera, and put question marks on them. I think we have pictures of those, just like in the game.
Oh,
so
nice.
He would stand. I had the music. I had the coin, the da-ding, 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 over and over again. I had the Super Mario Brothers music. The little one, Mario, would punch the box. All the candy would fall out. He had to save me, Princess Peach. And we were just running around this playground we broke into. And he had the time of his life. I think there's a few more pictures. But that is all Andy. He's such a good dad. And no matter if the chips are down and everything's stacked against us in this 50-50 situation, we always end up having the best time.
That's very cool. I have a question. Is the kid familiar with like the Mario original game? Like,
oh, yeah.
Okay.
Andy has one
Otherwise,
of those
it's just
hard
for
drives.
You guys.
He has one of those hard drives with every game that's ever existed. So it was very cute and he sort of saved Halloween. And afterwards, because my dad used to do this to me and I loved it, and this kid's very much like I am. So I interview him about everything. So we'll be sitting at dinner and, you know, if he made dinner, quote unquote, because he always makes dinner with me, I'll interview him about his process and what's his favorite ingredient and what was tough. And he always leans into my hand, my little invisible mic, like he really gets into it. So after the Mario, we're walking around, we're just eating candy and I'm interviewing him saying, you know, well, what was the hardest part? You know, and he loves it. He leans into my hand and he gives me all the answers. And we just had a good time, just the three of us.
Nice.
That's awesome.
Brian, yeah, what'd you do?
Nothing that elaborate. However, I was the I took charge on Halloween a couple of days ago. I texted just our neighbors right here on our block across the street from us. And I was like, hey, what do you guys think about doing just like a little, you know, trick or treat circuit, just, you know, the people we know. And they pretty much all said, yeah, it's a great idea. So we got a bag of candy, put it into like cellophane bags, tied it up, put from Tessa. Right. So if they came over to our house, just give them the bag and blah, blah, blah. It's the whole, you know, theater of the sanitary. So 3:30 in the afternoon rolls around on Halloween. We have the candy ready. Everyone's ready. You know, we're getting ready to go. And Tessa's watching Nightmare Before Christmas. And I'm like, I got to take a nap. I don't feel well. And 2 hours later, Christy comes into the bedroom. Like, are you okay? I was so sick. My stomach hurt. Not even like side effect stuff. Like I just had like a sore stomach. I was exhausted. I couldn't go. She's like, we're going to go trick-or-treating. You want to come? I'm like, I can't do it. I'm sorry. So they did the little round. I missed the whole thing. Tessa was excited. The silver lining, Tessa was excited this morning. It's funny you talk about like, oh, what's candy to a kid? Mm-hmm. To a four-year-old? She's like, what's this? What's this? She doesn't know any candy. She's like, what's that? I'm like, it's a Snickers bar. It's delicious. That's a 100 grand bar. You're going to love that. Oh. That whole thing.
Mm, $100,000 bar. Yeah.
That's right.
Underrated.
Great candy.
Yeah.
So we had a little circuit here of like six houses, just the neighbors, and Tess had a great time, and I missed the whole goddamn thing.
How do you feel now?
I feel a lot better. I felt terrible yesterday, but just
Does it have to do with your medication, or is it
illness. That's the most logical explanation. Luckily, I did not have a fever. I did not have like aches and chills and that whole thing. I was just exhausted and my stomach was like upside down. Like I just didn't feel well, and about 90% better today.
Good. I told Max Zapata after hearing that Sean Connery passed away. Chris said to me, "You want to give some words about Sean Connery?" And I was like, "I don't really have a lot of words about Sean Connery."
I mean, what you've said over the years really should suffice.
Interesting.
We'll do a super cut.
Interesting guy. I was explaining to someone that he won like Mr. Europe or something, like a bodybuilding, as a bodybuilder.
Well, he was a boxer. He was like a legit boxer. Like, I don't know, he wasn't pro, obviously. But
I've read a few eulogies today, and I missed that.
If memory serves, he was won like a bodybuilding competition. Wow. It wasn't Mr. Universe or USA, but it was like he won like or was a bodybuilder. I mean,
Mr. Glasgow.
Yeah, before they got in all the roids and everything. But anyway, I said, Sean Connery, like, what could I say about him? And then I thought, oh, there's that great clip. Came in third in Mr. Universe in 1950.
What? Damn. That's crazy.
Didn't realize that.
Mr. Universe, which covers most of the globe, and he came in third.
Most, if not all.
Yes, which is, he's up on the podium with the bronze in 1950. I mean,
amazing.
That's a genetic hand. But the only thing I could think about was he gave this interview with Barbara Walters in 1987. I thought, well, why don't we just play that?
Be remembered for
while promoting the Untouchables.
You did an interview in which you said, "It's not the worst thing to slap a woman now and then." As I remember, you said you don't do it with a clenched fist. It's better to do it with an open hand. Mm. Yeah, remember that?
Yeah.
Yeah. And I didn't love that.
I haven't changed my opinion.
You haven't?
No, not at all.
You think it's good to slap a woman?
No, I don't think it's good.
You don't think it's bad?
I don't think it's that bad. I think that it depends entirely on the circumstances and if it merits it. Yeah.
What would merit it?
Well, if you have tried everything else, and women are pretty good at this, they can't leave it alone. Yeah? They want to have the last word, and you give them the last word, but they're not happy with the last word. They want to say it again and get into a really provocative situation. Then I think it's absolutely right.
Man makes good points.
So you got there's a little window there when Barbara Walters goes, like, when is it okay? And you could say when she's endangering the children or when she's talking about suicide and you need you need her attention or something. Yeah. You can't go when you lose the argument.
Yeah.
When she
talks twice.
That's a problem.
What I'm saying is, it's like she's clearly shown some interest in this comment. She's going to open a window, and she's going to let you speak on it, and now's the time to modify. Mm-hmm. You know, now's the time.
Clarify.
When you could say, if she parks the car on the railroad tracks, the kids are in the car, and she won't respond to verbal commands, then you can slap her.
Yeah, when the smelling salts haven't worked and she's passed out, you can give her a little slap.
But not just because.
Right.
We got to get
inside the car with the tube coming from the exhaust pipe. By all means, slop away.
All right. We got to get that one and Deacon Jones and somehow put them together. Two of the greats, two of the physical specimens, and both gone too soon. All right. Mike. Oh, I'm sorry. Was it? We got Dan Dunn. Yeah. Mike Murphy. Because there is a Mike Guitar Murphy, I think, from the Blues Brothers.
Matt Guitar Murphy.
Oh, it's Matt Guitar Murphy. All right. Well, then screw that. Anyway, Mike Murphy, political consultant, political analyst. He's been on the show a bunch of times. He's got some strong opinions about what's going on with this election. So we can dissect it, and we'll do that with him right after this.
Adam Carolla's I'm Your Emotional Support Animal, navigating our all-woke, no-joke culture, has over 1,000 five-star reviews on Amazon. Here's one.
This booth is an absurd, literally, and hair rolling down my face. I was launching so hard at 3 a.m., and that was because I couldn't put it down.
That's pretty much what everyone's saying. Pick up I'm Your Emotional Support Animal, navigating our all-woke, no-joke culture, and leave your five-star review on Amazon. Get all the links at adamcarolla.com.
Well, we got Mike Murphy. You know Mike Murphy. He's a political consultant, a political analyst. Got some hot takes. Podcast Hacks on Tap with Mike Murphy and David Axelrod, available on Apple Podcasts and Spotify as well. Good to talk to you again, Mike.
Hey, good to be here, man.
So what are we thinking? What can we? I have no idea what's going on. I assume Biden's going to win, but that's about all I got.
Yeah, you know, all the numbers say Biden's going to win, all the polling. And then people always say, well, the polls were wrong last time. There's magic, you know, in the air. Donald Trump has like a secret ram's horn he can blow, and there's a secret vote. The fact is, the polls were pretty right about the national vote last time. It's just they didn't get the individual states right because they weren't looking at them. This year, they're looking at them. And, you know, it looks pretty grim for Trump and the big three that gave it to him last time, Wisconsin, Michigan, and Pennsylvania. And Biden's selling a lot of tickets in Arizona, Florida, North Carolina. So I think if you kind of get out of all the hype and the madness of it all and look at the numbers say Biden.
Is there anything I keep thinking about Biden, minus a hatred for Trump? Is there anything attractive about Joe Biden as a candidate, a president, or a leader? I can't find anything I like about Biden other than everyone hates Trump. But I don't know what there is. Yeah. Is there something attractive about Biden?
You know, on the candidate level, it's kind of like Ed McMahon for president. He's a classic right. sidekick, but the other guy is so bad. Now, if you get to people who really like Biden, and, you know, I'm one of these Republican cranks who hate Trump so much, I'm going to rent not buy this year. I'm voting for Biden. He's competent. He is a good wheeler dealer, old school politician. It's kind of funny, but he's the one guy who can get in a room with Mitch McConnell from the Democratic side and cut a deal. They actually get along. So at the kind of boring LBJ inside wheeling and dealing, he's quite good. He's just not the flashy, sharp, you know, Clinton type candidate, though he has the same kind of empathy. That's who he really is. And again, against Trump, you only got to kind of bunt a couple singles to beat him because the country wants to fire the guy.
It's funny. It's adjacent to what we were talking about, I don't know, a couple of days ago, about how Biden's frankly just not that exciting, and the voter enthusiasm on his side just really has never been there. But the enthusiasm anti-Trump is definitely, you know, amongst a certain population, is definitely there.
Yeah, there's
Trump lost the suburbs, man, and that is the wrong fight to pick in national politics.
Well, and it's also like we talked about so many times about the pendulum swinging. And, you know, and Adam, you've said many times, you know, we'll find out if America just wants normal. We just want boring. We don't
want sleepy. We want sleepy.
Yeah, you want sleepy. Well, he's running for president.
Yeah.
So we've done some ads for Biden, the best tagline in the testing and the chaos.
Mm-hmm. And the chaos, right.
But quick question. Yeah. Oh, go ahead.
So it's an interesting thing, Mike. So how much of the chaos is driven by the news and by Twitter and the, you know, social media? How much of the chaos is ginned up or generated versus, and maybe it's not an answerable question, but I feel like Trump, there's so much chaos, but it's like, half of it feels like just it's ginned up. Like, well, he went to the cemetery and he said, these guys are losers. And it turns into like this huge story, but we don't even know if he said these guys were losers. It didn't have to be a 3-day news cycle. You know, it turned into, oh, we got another thing. Now we did another thing, right. But it didn't have to be another thing. I don't even know if it was a thing.
The dirty little secret of cable news is that they are in every day has to be the biggest day of the campaign, because that way more eyeballs, more clicks, more dollars. So trivia gets elevated. And so Trump's a chaos, you know, spark plug. But they've all decided, hey, let's get in on the chaos industry here. It's growing. So it's the old, you know, Trump does something crazy. They put a spotlight on it. Then they got a bunch of people to go crazy about it. Then they go to the other side. Why don't you go crazy? And then, you know, so you're right. There's kind of a feedback loop to it. And I think that's part of the fatigue, that everything Trump says gets doubled by media attention.
Oh, well, sometimes, like I said, Trump doesn't even necessarily have to say something crazy. Someone can say Trump said something crazy.
Right.
And then we go into this huge sort of media thing, and it's 3 days of this is the biggest thing ever. And then it just goes away, and it's like nobody cares, as if it didn't happen.
On day three, Trump's thinking, hey, wait a minute, where's my role in all this? And he goes and tries to out-crazy the original semi-crazy thing. And then, you know, again, reset, and off we go again. And, you know, that's just kind of been, that's Trump's old days in New York trying to be on the cover of tabloid news. You know, he knows how to play that piano pretty well.
Gina?
Question. I heard this recently, and it may have been NPR. I'm not sure because it was being relayed. But they were talking about polling and, you know, how, and we've talked about like the Bradley effect and, you know, people aren't honest when they say who they're going to vote for. But what was much more accurate was when you ask people, well, who is your social circle voting for? Because they have no problem telling you who the people around them are voting for. They're just uncomfortable putting their name on it. So that has been apparently widely done and very accurate. Can you speak to that at all?
Well, there's one experiment USC did. There's some good European experiments that, like, called the Dutch election. But here, there's a big difference between the early social circle stuff, and we'll find out on election day, and some of the polling. The pollsters have gotten extremely sneaky. Because you ask like 600 people on a poll, and the 600 are very, you know, selected scientifically. And let's say that 60 of them, you know, 10% won't tell you or say they're undecided. In the old days, the pollster would say, hey, you got 10% undecided. Now they look at all the other questions they ask. They put some trick questions to kind of sniff them out. Then they actually
profile
the voter file, and they say, all right, here are these 60 people. And let's see what magazine subscriptions they have. Oh, look at that. Guns and ammo, Trump. You know, and so they get into their lives with all this consumer data and make a model projection of who they're actually for. It's kind of like database mind reading. And I'll tell you, it's pretty good. So
Is that like Cambridge Analytica type stuff or not?
Yeah, it's a little better than that. And the other thing about polling is, you see, cheap polling is like cheap brain surgery. Yeah, it looks good on paper until, you know, you're drooling for the rest of your life. Good polling is really expensive. So the newspapers don't do too much of it because they're cheap. It's the campaigns. Like, I'm spending $10 million against Trump down in Florida, Republican voters against Trump. So I'll go spring $50,000 for a really good poll of independent voters and do all that stuff because it's like the guidance system on the missile. The guys, you know, at the ABC, Fred's polling, who just want to get into, you know, a little bit of media coverage and sell the poll for $2,000 to five different newspapers. They're not as tight. So done well, it isn't perfect, but it tells you a lot. And the truth is this race, this thing has been sitting at 9 points forever. You know, the thing that's driving me crazy, because I'm having this alternative lifestyle here where I'm a Republican conservative, but I think Trump is so corrupt, I'm for Biden. So I'm hanging around with Democrats who I used to make a living running campaigns against. I've never seen such a bunch of bedwetters in my life. I'd rather have the French army behind me. They're 10 times tougher because all these guys, they're 10 points ahead. And, oh, I don't know.
What's
there was
happen,
a story
though?
On Twitter. We're going to lose. You know, it's like unbelievable.
Well,
they're in good shape.
I think what they've done is they've built Trump up. You know, there's Trump derangement syndrome. But there's also just they've built Trump up to be such a Hitlerian monster that if it's your choice between your guy and Mitt Romney, you're like, well, I like my guy, but I could do 4 years of Mitt Romney. It's not going to affect me. Mitt Romney's not a bad guy. It's not going to do anything to me. And I think normally you go into these elections where it's like, well, I like Bush and he likes Clinton. And it's like, yeah, but we don't think either one of them's evil. It's just it's kind of a policy thing. We'd like a little less regulation or a little less taxes or some version, something about immigration. But the media and a lot of people, Hollywood especially, has done such a crazy effective job of building Trump into this sort of Hitlerian monster that if you were thinking, you know, all right, what if you had your parents and you're going out on the town and you got your 7-year-old twins and you're like, there's a 90% chance you're going to get Mrs. Doubtfire as a babysitter, but there's a 10% chance you're going to get Charles Manson.
Right,
well, then
right.
you would be really worried that whole evening, right?
Right, right.
And
right,
you couldn't say to that person, no, just get ready, go out and have a good time. They'd be like, what if it's Charles Manson? Now, if it was sort of 90% Mrs. Doubtfire and 10% Mitt Romney or something, then you'd just be like, all right, well, we're going out. I hope we get Mrs. Doubtfire, but we're going out anyway. So the media and social media, and especially Hollywood, has built Trump into this crazy, like a caricature. And the, you know, like the ad campaigns are like, we're going to lose our freedoms. We're going to lose our democracy. Things are never going to be the same. He's never going to leave. It's going to be end of our world order as we know it. Well, if you build it up like that, then even if you have a 10% lead, you're still going to be wringing your hands because Hitler could be taking over.
Yeah, I think that's totally right. There's also, as much as I hate Trump, there's this weird, particularly on the coast, this weird kind of contempt for red state America. Like Trump has some magic powder and he's going to do a weird yodel at midnight tomorrow before the election. And this army of hillbilly zombies is going to come out of the, and there's kind of this sneering, you know, they don't even drive Teslas and right. they're all going to vote. And there's, and Mitch McConnell and his Dracula cape is, you know, there's this big thing. And the part of America they hate, sometimes it's their audience, by the way, is going to come out and do this big dumbass Trump takeover. The thing is, betting against the numbers in politics is like betting against the casino pit boss. You know, that's how a lot of college funds go up in smoke. And the numbers for Biden are strong, but I get the neurosis. You're right about that. They're so worked up.
Well, again, if it was, if there was a 10% chance you were going to get hit with a pie in the face, you could do that. But if there's a 10% chance you're going to be impaled on rusty rebar, you'd worry the whole day, right? And for some people, Trump is being impaled on rusty rebar. So,
and it's a 15% chance. So
right.
there they go. They might have something to worry about.
Well, I really feel like that's what we're seeing, because the harder core you are to the left, the more hand-wringing you're doing, right?
Yeah.
The slightly more moderate folks are probably not wringing their hands as hard. So what is the future of the news? And do they really want Trump to lose? Now, I feel there's a lot of evidence for this. It's pretty safe to say that the mainstream news outlets are 90% of them are against Trump, or maybe it's 95% are against Trump. I mean, there is some sort of, I think maybe 18 out of the 20 major news organizations are sort of negative on Trump.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems like with recent events, Twitter, Facebook, social media, they're all against Trump too. So what is their business model? Like, if I'm CNN, do I really want Trump out of there? I mean, I feel like it's pretty good business for me. Maybe I personally hate the guy, but it's good for the, I don't know. I feel like I'm a vegetarian who has a hot dog stand. You know what I mean? I don't want to convert I don't want everyone to be vegan. I'm selling brats over here.
Yeah. I'm in the ice cream business, and I don't like the idea of winter weather. You know, it's just kind of bad for the franchise. I would say the higher you go up in the elevator, the more they might be thinking that way for the business. I think the rank and file, they kind of tilt left to begin with. And then Trump has just been so hostile to journalism, and he does lie a lot, that he kind of offends them on that level too. So they've kind of taken the gloves off with Trump. I mean, my Trump friends say, hey, he's getting an unfair treatment from me. I go, yeah, you're right. But he sure worked hard to earn it, because he's busted so many boundaries. I would say, if you're sitting at the top of Fox, it's good if he loses, because now you can be Fort Revenge and go after the Dems all day long, which is kind of easier than defending him. If you're CNN, you just want politics to be hot. As long as there's fighting going on and, you know, there's conflict, you're selling tickets. If you're MSNBC, you got to figure out your new plan, because right now they're radio hate Trump. And if Trump's gone, you know, then they're going to have to kind of figure out, are they going to cover the Democratic liberal versus center Dem war? Are they going to be the fawning, you know, Biden's always right channel? That's probably not a good way to raise the eyeballs. They got some thinking to do there.
What about what are the chances that he makes it Biden all the way through his first term? I mean, Biden seems like there's some decline there, and he seems like, I don't know that he'll physically die 4 years from now, but it seems like there's some decline mentally. And it also feels like those conditions sometimes speed up toward the end. You know what I'm saying? And I feel like Kamala Harris maybe making some decisions.
Well, I think he's pretty sharp, but he's old. And as you get older, and it's the hardest damn job in the world, because every day you go in, you know, and there's bad news. It's never like, hey, Mr. President, everything's great. And instead, it's like, hey, the Roswell alien got away, and turns out we found an atomic bomb in a shipping container in Jacksonville. I mean, a lot of it we don't hear about. And so it ages you, and he's already starting out really old. So the presumption is he's not going to run again, which means in about 18 months, the people who would like to be the next president, it's a cutthroat business, they start circling Kamala, thinking we're not going to give it to her for free. And she starts thinking about the big picture. Maybe she won't show up for that unpopular press conference on the Biden plan to raise taxes on whatever. Now, simultaneously, anybody who's had that job, often the last to say I'm ready to retire is the guy with the job, because as hard as it is, it's a pretty good job. So I don't know, you know, what Biden will be thinking, but I do think three years in, he's going to have to take a hard look at the mirror and see if he's up for it. And if he's aged a lot, then that this decision might be made for him.
There's a guy, Mike August, brought his name up. And he heard you talking about him on your podcast. And I said to Mike August, I don't know, 8 months ago, a year ago, I said, Dan Crenshaw, man.
Yeah.
Keep your eye, pardon the pun. Easy. Or no. Well, actually, just keep your eye.
Just keep the eye.
On him. I said, that guy's so goddamn impressive to me. I've heard him speak. I've interviewed him a couple times. I've actually been on stage with him. I've had a beer with him after the show. And I just thought, wow, that guy is the opposite of Trump in the same party. First things first, I love pragmatism. I love pragmatism. And he's super pragmatic. The reason I hate most Democrats is I can't stand all the fucking race hustling. It drives me nuts. It's such an easy
identity
card.
Politics.
It's such a cheap, weak, and easy card to play when you're losing an argument. Dan Crenshaw, first off, I mean, obviously the military background, but the guy is good. He's good on his feet. He's squeaky clean, and you know. It's hard to punch holes in his argument. So with Trump, you can have a debate with him, but at some point you just call him a racist and you can get on with your life. You're going to have trouble with that with Dan Crenshaw, although if he runs, he will be labeled a racist. He will be labeled a racist and a homophobe by the Democrats. Be prepared. So we can look forward to that. But I think that guy's the future.
Yeah, look, what's going to happen is we're going to have a civil war in the party, and it's going to be like the Chinese Civil War. There'll be 20 warlords driving around with 2,000 people. But in the midterm elections, some stars are going to be discovered, and I would bet cash money he'll be one of them, because he's really kind of the full package. He's been playing his Republican politics smart, too. I mean, I'm a huge fan of the guy. I was a little disappointed he wasn't tougher on Trump. But as you say, he's no idiot. And he's saying, I got to get through a Republican primary to move up the ladder. And, you know, I don't want to be banged on for being disloyal. So I think he swallowed hard, because I'll bet if you put truth serum in him, he'd have a view of Trump similar to mine. I'm lucky I don't have to run for anything, so I can go bloviate about how bad Trump is. So, yeah, Crenshaw, if I had to make a short list of like the five folks who are going to be discovered, I'd put him at the top of the new face list. I totally agree. He's got the full package and a Texas base, which in Republican Party politics, as former President Bush, one or two, it's a powerful thing.
Then we should talk sort of timeline, because I think Biden will probably win, Biden is going to have to kind of deal with his own party a little bit because he's got the slightly more radical lefts that are going to be pushing.
Yeah, big problem.
Yeah, it seems like a problem for him because they're going to be pushing some pretty aggressive shit. If he starts going down that road, I think it'll fuck up the economy and I think the country will hate it. And then we'll get to the end of that 4 years and Dan Crenshaw will be the yin to that yang. He will be the opposite to that sort of AOC kind of Bernie kind of leftist kind of agenda. And I think if Biden sort of drifts left and starts going with the kind of listening to the Beto O'Rourke's and the AOC's and the squad and that whole group, he's going to set the table for Dan Crenshaw. And also, we won't have the sort of Trump derangement stuff that we're dealing with anymore. Now, if Biden kind of stays toward the center a little more, it's not going to set the table quite as much for a guy like Dan Crenshaw.
Yeah, and that's where Biden's instincts are. The problem is the votes in the House particularly. You know, Pelosi's pushing back on some of it. They're pretty AOC-ish, and they're hungry, and he's got Bernie and that faction in the Senate. So it'll be tricky. I think Biden is secretly hoping the Democrats don't win a big Senate advantage so he can use the Republicans and his secret buddy McConnell to say, hey, to the left, hey, I can't do that. I got to get something out of the Republicans. They're going to block me to kind of maneuver. Crenshaw, if he's smart, one, you're seeing him do a State of the Union response. I'm sure they're using for that, start to give a national profile. Then he'll hit the road in 2022. Normally, the opposing party does well in the midterms of the new president. He'll go hit 100 congressional races, and if they've done their staff work, he'll have the best 12 minutes, tight 12 minutes. This is the old Reagan trick that anybody's seen in the party, and he'll just blow the doors off 80, 90 congressional events. At the end, he'll be able to claim credit for electing 7 new guys. So he'll be the fresh winner, and the party after Trump is going to be desperate for a winner who's, you know, not a lunatic. And then he's in business, and he's got to find $100 million of donors. He's already doing direct mail, building a national mailing list. I mean, he's making the moves to be ready to do this. So I think you've kind of found something that normally only technocrats are seeing going on under the surface, but they're totally working at it. But so will, you know, Cruz, Rubio, Josh Hawley, Tom Cotton, the 2 senators. There's going to be no shortage of people in the party who look at Kamala Harris and say, we can beat her if she's the nominee in 4 years. But I tell you, Crenshaw is a new face, too. And after the same old guys in D.C., it's a good card.
I don't see Ted Cruz. Yeah, I don't see him really mounting anything. I think people want a fresh face. And Brian, you had a question?
Beard. Yeah, a follow-up question, Mike, for you. You mentioned, alluded to something that I've been wondering, and actually you kind of both did, because if the polls are correct and it's a large, you know, win for Biden, what happens to the Republican Party? You mentioned a civil war. I'm curious where they go from there, because it feels like the hardest core Trump supporters aren't down with someone who's a little more towards, you know, the moderate side or less Trumpy, for example. Adam, you mentioned it's crazy that Crenshaw and Trump are in the same party, but here we are. Where do you think it goes from there?
Well, that's the big, big question. So there are 2 theories. What the cocktail party circuit in D.C. will tell you is it's all Trump forever. He's got a big Svengali lock. If he loses, his army will still rule everything. I don't buy that. I'm the other, more contrarian theory, which is it's on a lesser scale. There were 8 months where Sarah Palin, after, you know, she got discovered, she had a lock on the party. They were all afraid she'd come in and endorse their opponent. Today, you can get her to open a shopping center for $500. So,
I'll
you
do
know,
it for $250. I don't even need to do it for $500.
Right. If you throw in the Greyhound ticket, yeah. So my point is, losing doesn't pay in politics. We've lost the House under Trump. We've lost 9 governorships. And it looks like we're quite likely to lose more House seats than even the Senate, let alone the presidency. So there's going to be a demand for a change. That won't make Trump go away. He'll go get a streaming deal. Maybe his son will try to run. But I don't think the big war is less about Trump and more about what the party stands for. Are we Crenshaw opportunity conservatism for everybody to succeed, anti-identity politics? The Democrats see the country as a bunch of groups with grievances and stacking who's got more grievances. The Republicans, when we win, we're one unified vision of, hey, we're going to fix the institutions of moving up in America and get everybody a fair shot, regardless of where they came from. And Crenshaw is that kind of candidate. So it's going to be the kind of opportunity, growth, positive conservatives with strength versus the Trump populism, which is here 12 people I'm pissed at. You know, that Mexican guy across the street, I bet you didn't know he tunneled in to, you know, steal your job. And I don't know. I think the Trump card is played, but he'll start with some power in that civil war. I just think they're going to want to change back to the sunnier side of things with somebody who's serious. I mean, Crenshaw, hell, he was a star at the Harvard JFK school, you know, and decorated combat veteran.
Oh, yeah.
He really has a lot of big brain, big story. So we'll see, but it'll be a hell of a fight.
Gina.
Real quick, and Adam's mentioned this before, and it hasn't come up, so I'm very curious. You know, we've had the Bush dynasty. Do you have any thoughts on a Trump dynasty with one of the kids, Ivanka, Donald Jr.?
You know, I think they will try. But I guess bad news for Trump, and again, as a psychopathic Irish Trump hater, I think the good news for America is we sit here figuring out the election. There are about 22 first in their class at law school graduates at the Southern District of New York in the U.S. Attorney's Office who are waiting to do a few rounds with Trump, it looks like, on his tax returns. And knowing what we know about Trump, I have a feeling that his tax return is not probably a model of perfect tax compliance. Mm. So he might have other problems.
Got it.
But yeah, one of them will try. I mean, they think they have an army. We're going to find out.
You know, it's interesting. So Brian was talking about how Dan Crenshaw and Donald Trump could sort of exist in the same party. It's really a more of a personality thing, I think, than a policy thing. Trump's been pretty conservative in terms of his policies. Like, I don't think Dan Crenshaw and Trump would be that far off on policy, but they're a million miles away on personality.
Sure.
And that's the new world order we're living in.
Yeah.
I think if you told them to write down their policies on 10 major subjects like immigration, taxes, regulation, school choice, and all that kind of stuff, I don't think you'd know the difference between Trump and Dan Crenshaw's policies, but they're so polar opposite in the personality department. And now social media and the news cycle and everything is so personality driven. And good news, like I used to say all the time when they'd go like, that's the kind of guy I could have a beer with. And I'd go, I'm never going to have a beer with the president. I want the policy. I don't care about the kind of guy I'd want to have a beer with. I had a beer with Dan Crenshaw already, so it's preemptive.
Oh, that's the kind of guy I've had a beer with.
That's right.
You got to move to tax-free New Hampshire because that vote's worth a lot. I think you're right on most of it. Where Crenshaw, I think, would say, and say louder if Trump loses, where he disagrees, is the national security stuff. You know, Trump wants to go piss off all our allies. Crenshaw's a classic guy, cares about NATO, cares about all that stuff because allies are important. And he'd also disagree with him on trade. You know, this protectionism and the dumb trade war. I don't think Crenshaw's for any of that. But you're right on taxes. You're right on dereg, you know, judges, things like that. So I don't think Crenshaw would be like an anti-Trump candidate, but he'd push every conservatism in a more modern direction.
Well, he would just deliver a lot of the stuff a lot of Americans want, which is, you know, a strong border, strong military, lower taxes. He'd do it in just a much more palatable way. And in which case, when it's coming out of Trump's mouth, you go, oh, fuck that. When it comes out of Dan Crenshaw's mouth, you go, yeah, we should have a strong border and a strong military, and we should lower the regulations.
Well, I'm an old John McCain guy, and I can tell you Crenshaw can talk about serving the country above his own self-interest. Trump can't.
Right.
You know, that's the billion-dollar contrast.
Hey, Mike, we're out of time for the segment, but let me give you a plug. Hacks on Tap with Mike Murphy and David Axelrod. Very interesting discussion. Thanks, Mike Murphy.
Thank you, man.
Appreciate it. We'll talk again soon.
Take care.
All right. Let's see. Let me hit Simply Safe here. That's right. Break-ins on the rise. Maybe TPing has gone up 86% over the last couple of days during the holidays. So Simply Safe is having a huge holiday sale. 30% off any system and free security camera. Whether you're traveling or staying put for the holidays, you check out 30% off plus free security camera. The deal ends this week, so get going. I use Simply Safe. We use Simply Safe. You, no drilling, no mess, no pulling wires. Batteries last up to 10 years. U.S. News and World Report calls it the best home security of 2020, and CNET gives it their Editor's Choice Award. Arsenal of sensors and cameras set up yourself. Takes about 30 minutes, and you're covered. You can get a break on your insurance as well. It's Simply Safe, right, Dawson?
Get 30% off Simply Safe plus a free security camera today by visiting simplysafe.com/Adam. Go today. The deal is this week only. That's simplysafe.com/Adam. Simplysafe.com/Adam.
All right. Dan Dunn is going to join us with some cocktails. I think we're going to do whiskeys.
American whiskey.
American whiskey.
USA.
We will do that right after this.
It's time to check Adam's voicemail.
So Rogan moved to Austin, Shapiro moved to Nashville. When are you moving to New Orleans, and where do I submit my resume? Get it on. Mahalo.
You can leave us a message at 888-634-1744.
Yeah, New Orleans seems like, it's kind of like, I don't know, it seems like moving to Vegas to me. Like, seems like a place you could visit, but doesn't seem like a place to live. But, and I've never been in the South. Like, I've never had that humid, wet heat. You know, everyone always just makes a noise, and I've always
you think your hair is tough to handle now.
Yeah. Oh, no. Yeah, I know. I can barely get the cornrows in it now. I could imagine moving to the Big Easy over there. Although I'll tell you one thing that's very attractive about New Orleans. I was in New Orleans when Jimmy and I did a man show. We did a man show bit out there, and we were grand marshal of some parade after Tommy Lasorda dropped out, so we had to throw everyone Tommy Lasorda beads and confuse them. It's a little confusing. But anyway, the greatest thing I ever heard was at some point Jimmy and I took a tour of New Orleans, and this like black guy in a minivan like picked us up. He's going to take us to all the places and the poets and the graveyards and everything. And he was kind of hustling this car around, and it was like on a main street, you know, 35 was the posted speed limit. This guy must have been doing 50. It was just kind of hustling, and I spotted a cop. And I started yelling, because I'm from L.A., like, cop, 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 because we're coming up on a cop. Like, in L.A., if a cop, hi, Dan Dunn, if you go along a freeway and there's a motorcycle cop just going down the middle of the freeway, he can just sit in that middle lane and go 53 miles an hour, and there'll be a whole line of cars behind him. Like, it's literally, he becomes a pace car to start the Indy 500. Like, no one will pass a cop. And
he's the grand marshal of the parade.
Yes, and this guy gave the tour. He just blew right past this guy. I was yelling cop, and he just looked at me and he goes, that guy's got bigger fish to fry. And I thought, oh, you're not scared of your police force. That's nice.
He's got bigger po'boys to eat.
That's right. I thought that was a reason to move. Dan Dunn, what's going on?
Hey, guys. How are you?
Good, man.
Excited.
It's interesting thing about New Orleans. You know, they have drive-through. You can drive through and get a cocktail. Okay.
Right.
Drive through, get a hurricane, drive through. So I actually looked this up to find out how this could be legal. And what makes it legal is this. When you buy your drink, you'll have a straw in there. Now they'll tear the top half of the bottom half off, put the straw in, but the top half is on there. And as long as the top half of that straw is on there, the assumption is, or you know how they get around it is, you're not going to drink that thing till you get home, because how could you pull that off while you're driving?
God forbid you pull the lid off. Yeah,
that's why it's legal.
You don't have to pull the lid off. All you have to do is open the window, and exactly. the top of the straw, Gina. It's just literally the paper on the top of the straw. You could just open your window, and that thing would exit stage right. All right, so Dan, what are we talking about today?
Well, you know, this is a big week, and I know a lot of people are focused on politics. So the idea, politics being this thing that kind of divides us, and American politics, and I thought you know what? American whiskey can be the great uniter.
Amen.
And so I decided to bring in four fantastic American whiskeys that I hope we can all agree are fantastic, whatever side of the aisle you're on, so to speak. We're all going to be on board with these whiskeys. Now, the ones that I've chosen here, there are three of the four whiskeys we're going to have tonight are bourbon. And the other one is a Rocky Mountain single malt whiskey, which I'm assuming you guys have not had before. So I figured we'll start with that. And it's Stranahan's is the name of the whiskey. It's an interesting story. A guy named Jess Graber was a volunteer firefighter in Woody Creek, Colorado, right outside of Aspen, former home of Hunter S. Thompson, the late, great Hunter S. Thompson. It was a fire at a barn owned by a longtime local named George Stranahan. He happened to be the guy that sold Hunter his property, by the way, back in the late 60s. And the fire happened. Jess put out the fire. One thing led to another. And they both loved whiskey, and they started Stranahan's. In 2004, the first bottle came off the line. In 2006, it's the first distillery in Colorado since Prohibition. Everything in this whiskey from grain to glass is Rocky Mountain ingredients, all the grain, all the water, everything comes there. They're based in Denver. It's a great distillery. When the time comes, we can go visit again. They got a great tasting room there. It's the official whiskey of Red Rocks Amphitheater. If you go to see a concert at Red Rocks, that's what you're going to be drinking. In fact, I went there a few years ago. They had a press dinner, and we had dinner on the stage at Red Rocks. So thank you, Stranahan's. And this is a new expression that we're going to taste called Blue Peak. It's the first line extension since 2017, and it is named for a 13,000-foot peak right in Aspen. So Blue Peak whiskey is what we're going to do here. Everybody's got their bottles, right?
Yeah, and they say they describe it as rich and mellow, which are things that we all love.
Well, let's find out, shall we?
We're doing this neat to start with, I assume?
Yeah, let's do it. Let's do it neat. We're going to put it in. And as always, as I tell you guys, the first thing you want to do is you want to nose this thing. You don't want to ram your nose into the glass. You want to kind of hover above the glass. Keep your mouth open a little bit and breathe the whole thing in. Like, that's what you want to just breathe it in and get yourself ready to actually taste it. Okay, so here we go.
What?
Cheers.
Dan.
Yes.
Hoisting a few on the stage at Red Rock sounds awesome.
Pretty cool.
But
it was,
were the annoying people exercising there, running up and down the fucking stairs, proving to you they're better than they are?
They didn't allow anybody in. And what's really cool about
Red Rock, better than you are. Sorry, go ahead.
If you've never gone, when you go down in underneath, it's all rock. It's just built into the rock. Every band that ever played there has signed the walls and stuff in magic marker. And it's just the whole hallway. It's just a rich, rich history of all this stuff. It's a great place. But yeah, nobody was exercising. It was just a lot of drinking and eating that night. So you got your, there's Brian. Look, there's Brian doing what I told him not to do, ramming his nose into the glass. Come on. Oh,
that's just the angle.
All right. So you guys, I'm getting a lot of nutmeg and cinnamon off the bat with this thing. And spices. Like a smoky kind of thing. You guys getting that going on?
Delicious.
Yes. So, boy, this is, what does this retail for? Well, we won't do the guessing game.
You're not going to do the guessing game? This is
he said
$470,000.
No. Okay.
I won't tell you if you don't want me to tell you.
We'll guess. We'll guess at the end. But this is nice. The first thing, I really like a nice caramely color. I don't know, in a whiskey. There's something about it. The light stuff, the green stuff. I don't like the lighter stuff or the greener stuff. I know it's mossy and that kind of stuff. But I love that kind of caramely looking. The proof on this one is what?
This is, what does it say on the bottle here? Where is the proof?
43%, so 86.
Do you guys, by the way, have we ever talked about what proof is? Do you guys know what proof is? Do you know what it means? Where the term came from?
Tell us, enlighten us.
I can't believe in all the times that I've been on this show. Okay.
Well, so every time you come on, we get drunk.
We drink.
We kind of shake the Etch-a-Sketch. So,
right. Well, look, here's the thing. In the U.S., the word proof's been around, I think, like 1848, something, if memory serves. And it's straight up 2 times alcohol by volume. So obviously this is 43% ABV, so it's 86 proof. Where the term dates back to is 16th century England. spirits were taxed at a different rate depending on their alcohol content. So the government had a way of testing. They would soak gunpowder with the alcohol and try to set it on fire. And if it lit, that proof that the alcohol content in the liquor was high and it would be taxed at a higher rate. Wow. That's where it came to.
Had a scientific way to evaluate of whether you're retarded or not. If your hand was bigger than your face.
Go ahead, okay? Put it up there.
All right. So this is okay. Good. This is awesome. Scrumdilicious.
It is a fantastic whiskey. I mean, it's one of my favorites. I think Stranahan's was one of the forebears of the craft whiskey movement here in the States. And they also, what's cool about this is they age it in a Solera process. That's where they keep moving it around different barrels. And that's usually reserved for wine. And I think what that does is it really just adds a marrying those different barrels and keeping, there's always some in each barrel being moved around. And I think it just kind of amplifies the flavor on this, but this one's just got, it's got a real nice body to it. And on the palate, I'm getting butterscotch and I'm getting, getting apples. Anybody get like an apple pie sort of thing going on there? But then there's pepper and on the back and that oak. You're getting the char from the oak on there too.
There is, I know we have nothing to compare it to yet, but there is no downside to this whiskey. This is fantastic.
Yeah.
Well, I love it as well. And I'm glad we got to try it because it's a worthy whiskey. We've had a lot of great whiskeys here on this show, but I think this one rates right up there. So now, if you want, we can move on to our bourbons.
Okay? Hey, Dan. Ooh. Dan, yes. would this be a fair statement? Back in the day, of course, all wine was French or, I don't know, from Spain or something, but there wasn't really California American stuff. And we kind of looked down our noses at American wine or California wine way back. Now, I think it's fair to say we're in the game. We may be leading the game. Are we doing that with whiskey now? I know there's always been a lot of distilleries and, you know, all the Jack Daniels and the Jim Beams, but the upper shelf stuff didn't seem to exist so much in the past. Now I feel like we're there now.
Well, yes, the short answer to that is yes. I mean, the whiskey category in general was in a lot of trouble in the late 20th century. Vodka, when Absolut came out and the premium vodkas, they started to crush the brown spirits. And I mean, and that was across the board, not just in America. I mean, we've talked about this before with Irish whiskey. Irish whiskey was almost wiped out completely. You know, there were three Irish whiskeys. But in terms of the premium stuff, I think America is making, you know, the best in terms of diversity, what you can get, different styles of whiskey. I don't think there's any place better than America right now that's making whiskey.
USA.
I
mean, that's
a picture.
Yeah. All right, that's Dan, right. What's next?
So bourbon, as we know, is a distinctive product of the United States. That was declared by the U.S. Senate in 1964.
Yeah.
We know the rules. We've talked about the rules before. It must be distilled no higher than 160 proof. It's got to be barreled at 125 proof or less. And then they keep watering it down and it got to be, in the barrel at 125, in the bottle at 80 proof at least. Okay. So now we're going to start off with, this is a really special whiskey. It's called Little Book Chapter 4. This is a Beam product. It's the first product released by Freddie Noe, who is the eighth generation Beam distiller. He's the son of the current Beam master distiller, Fred Noe, and he's the grandson of Booker Noe, okay, who was Jim Beam's grandson. Yeah, so this product is a limited edition series, Little Book. And it's called Little Book because that was Freddie's nickname, Little Book, Little Booker. That's what it was, a childhood nickname. So this one is, boy, let's pour this in the glass first and get rolling on this.
Point out that this is 122 proof. This might be the strongest alcohol you've brought in here, Dan.
Well, you know, it's a
good thing.
Hey, nobody's driving, right? Yeah. All right, here we go. So
122 proof. Wow.
Yeah. So this is going to have a kick to it.
Yeah. Oh, God, I can't wait to cook after this. It's going to be a disaster.
It's 122.8, actually. So we're almost at 123. There are three different with components in this blend here. There's a 4-year-old Kentucky straight brown rice bourbon. There's an 8-year-old Kentucky straight high rye. So you're going to get spice from that. And then there's a 7-year-old Kentucky straight bourbon. That's what makes up the mix for this. Now, as you said, there's a lot of alcohol. So be careful when you're nosing this thing. So here we go.
Oh boy. Cheers.
Cheers to you. I get the vanilla right up front. I get the cherry right up front. I get the smoke. This is a decadent. Are you okay?
Gina, please. It's pretty
strong. God. This gets you where you live. I feel exhilarated.
This is not for the faint of heart.
No, this is a big jump from Stranahan's Rich and Mellow.
Yeah.
What do you think?
Pretty strong. It might take you, a weekend to drink this.
Yeah.
Ace, what do you think on this one?
Well, you can really feel the alcohol in it, you know, so it's not for the novices. You can really feel it. Now, I don't know if you take something like this and you step on it with a couple drops of water and then you're living in the sort of best of both worlds kind of place where you have this high end alcohol, but it's not quite, so what it is now, it's like. It's like a really good chili sauce that's so hot that you might not be able to appreciate the flavor of the chili sauce. But if you cut it down a little, add a little rice to it or something, then maybe you can appreciate the chili sauce. So like if we step on it with a little baby laxative,
I put a little water in mine, and that's a great suggestion, Adam, because what that does is it sort of, it tamps down the alcohol a little bit and gives you, now if try it after you put a little water in it, you're going to really be able to pick up the different flavors that you might have missed because the alcohol is so strong. So when I'm trying this now, I'm getting some cherry, a little bit of cherry, believe it or not, but a lot of spice. And I think that's from the, that's coming from the high rye. The 8-year-old high rye is going to create that, you're always going to get spice off a rye grain. Oh, go ahead.
I was going to say, I dropped an ice cube in here, and the flavors are much more forward. You know what I mean? I don't get the punch in the face. I get the flavors like you're talking about. Yeah.
This is a serious whiskey. This is a whiskey for people who are seasoned drinkers. Like, if you're sitting around the table with people that really know their whiskey, this is going to be the one that's going to kind of blow everybody away. But I wouldn't recommend this necessarily to a novice whiskey drinker.
You know what this whiskey makes me think of? This is Fight Club whiskey. This is, I got punched in the face and I liked it. And I want to come
happy,
back for more.
Gina, you look really happy
great.
There now.
Yeah, but it was really, it was quite a, shock to the system. And now I'm digging it.
Yeah, well, you can taste the rye.
So then the next one we got, this is a real interesting one. Let's try the few straight bourbon whiskey. Now, what's interesting about few, this is another grain to glass distillery. When I say that, that means everything happens at the distillery. They're not sourcing out anything. This was founded in 2011 in Evanston, Illinois. And what's really fascinating about that is Evanston was the cradle of the temperance movement. That's where it started. Prohibition's roots began in Evanston, Illinois. Yeah, and Prohibition lasted in Evanston until the 1970s. You couldn't get alcohol in Evanston, Illinois.
My family is from Evanston. This has never come up.
Really?
Everybody's from Evanston. My aunt and uncle still live right across the football field from not NYU. I'm drunk. Thank you.
Yeah.
It's always funny. The thing I like about this country is all these things, these like luminaries and presidents and temperance movement. It always comes from some town I've never heard of. It's never from Burbank, California. It's never a big one. It's always a small one. You know,
it's a suburb of Chicago.
You never heard of Evans? Evanston's where Northwestern University is.
Oh, I have no.
Why would that?
They're kind of relevant in
football. I could tell you every uniform and every team in college, but I would have no idea. I've always told you, I had no idea where Notre Dame was my entire sure. life. I had no idea. I could tell you Nebraska was Nebraska. That was pretty easy. But all these other Northwesterns and these schools, Temple and I went to
Temple.
I think Bill Cosby taught me.
Philadelphia.
The great Bill Cosby.
Hell, by the way, speaking of bartenders. Oh, wait, no. Too soon? Wrong. Don't ever try anything Bill's making. I'll tell you.
Yeah, all of these were sealed when they arrived.
I was thinking about, I think Bill Cosby, he gets all those honorary degrees. And then I think all these colleges took back their honorary degrees that they've given him over the last, 30 years. And if I was Bill Cosby, I'd be like, you want your honorary degree back? Okay, well, good. They're still in the trunk of my vulva. So it's not like I got to go to my fucking office. I never pulled them out of the car, so I'll swing by. All right, go ahead, Dan.
He gave the speech at my graduation.
Really?
Wow.
Yes, he did.
What was happening?
He was so inspirational. who knew? Who knew what was going on behind the scenes with old Bill?
He told you to pull your pants up, but only if you're a guy.
Exactly. Now back to the few. Now this is a straight bourbon whiskey with the mash bill on this. And we know the mash bill is the mix of grains that go into it. 70% corn. So you're going to get some sweetness there. 20% northern rye. Here comes the spice. And then 10% malt. Okay. This is a 93 proof whiskey. This, the yeast that they use, and Brian, you like beer, right? You're a beer drinker? The yeast that they use for this is a very peppery yeast that they normally use to make Saison beers. Mm. So they're ramping up the spice on this one. So
favorite beer by far.
Oh, boy. Well, let's see.
The whiskey is good.
Is that the gym sock beer?
Yes. Saison is very pungent, very astringent. Some people say it's fruity, but it's
isn't that Dawson's Groove?
No, we were in Phoenix.
I know we were in Vegas.
We were in Vegas. Right. Some of the Phoenix when we were on the radio, the Phoenix promotions director joined us at that restaurant, and you went off about how this beer tastes like a sweat sock, and then this guy joined us, and he goes, "Oh, that's the best beer I ever had."
Yeah, that's kind of my life. Yeah. Well, I used to, when I had a job, I had one of those jobs. I had a lot of jobs. It's kind of like slow motion prostitution where they'd go like, look, I'll give you $80. But instead of $80 for a blowjob, it'd be $80 for the day. You know what I mean? You just come out to this place. There's a van. You got to drive the van to Santa Barbara. I'll give you $80. I'd have a lot of those sort of
one-offs.
Yeah. And one of them was setting up cheap art. You see, you ever go into a dentist office or something, you see that big stupid painting behind the sofa, generic. And you're like, what is that?
Forgettable.
Where do they get that? Well, this place did that, and we set up about 200 paintings on easels, and then people are going to come by and like bid on it. And out of the 200 paintings, there was one that was fucking horrible that I just looked at. I was 19. I didn't have much of an aesthetic, but I was like, this painting's a piece of shit. And I singled it out. And then a guy walked up and he goes, I love this painting. I'm going to bid on it. And then he goes, I call it Love of Life. And he walked away. And I was like, are you just following me around and shitting on my points? But that's basically what happened with the beer.
Within seconds.
Yeah. Yes. All right. Sorry.
Well, I have to say, I'm getting a bit of chocolatey, at least in the smell. And dare I say, at least from what we've sampled so far, this is refreshing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Nice.
It's approachable.
It definitely is. Again, I'm getting the cinnamon and a little bit of clove too, but I am really getting that sweetness from the corn, because 70% is a pretty high content of a percentage of corn in the mash bill. It has to be 51%, but we're going up to 70 here. But this is who said it was approachable? I think that was you, Brian, that said that. Yeah, I think absolutely.
He only uses those kind of words.
Yeah. I say,
I was making fun of those people.
I say it's assertive without being pushy.
I say it's buttery with an oaky finish.
Yeah, this is nice.
This is very nice. Sippable.
Yeah, I'm really enjoying this few. And then, as I said, I take a perverse pleasure in drinking this one, because it's like, that's where these motherfuckers started Prohibition, which I think any drinker could agree was the darkest time. 13 years. Can you imagine that? Alcohol was illegal in the United States for 13 years. And in Evanston, they kept it going until 1970s.
I think I could probably handle it, but not past the age of two. So if I was 41 and they tried pulling that shit, I would just fucking start building a still in my backyard. I probably could handle it if I was in kindergarten and just had to fucking had to white knuckle it until 16 and a half or 17. No way now. That I would literally just go, look, I got to leave the country. That's it.
And virtually every law that we have in the country, we all know there's a million bullshit laws related to alcohol, and every one of them stems from prohibition. So what happened was, you know, it was religious, and it was the country's out of control. We got to stop it. And then after prohibition ended, then people started going, there's a lot of ways we can make money here. You know, we could start keeping some of these rules around and making them pay to get around the rules or doing it. I mean, think about Utah. I mean, up until very recently, maybe even still doing that, the 1 ounce pour, you know, all goes back. That's all from the Mormon community. And that, you know, a lot of these laws, all the so-called blue laws that we have, Colorado is a great example. In Colorado on Sundays, you can only buy 3.2 beer. That's the highest alcohol that can be in the beer just on Sunday. So they make special, special beers at 3.2% ABV so they can sell it on Sundays in Colorado. Do you think that has anything to do with people drinking too much? Or no, it's just purely money now. It's purely a money-making thing.
See, we used to have to drive to Missouri in Kansas to get alcohol on Sundays. So yeah, I mean, there's a lot of that shit that's still left over.
I figured out a way around the 3.5 in Colorado on Sundays. What I'd do, open 2 3.5s and mix them. I get to a nice fat 7.0. That's the way I stick it to the man.
That's just good math. Yeah.
It's crazy that, and not surprising, that prohibition overlapped with the Great Depression. And the Great Depression, I have no doubt, brought on the end of prohibition. Like, listen, if we're going to fucking have nothing to eat and put bread lines, like, we need booze.
All right. This is awesome. They're all awesome.
One more.
Dan,
one more.
Yeah, we'll get going quick here because Gina's got her news and she's.
Let's do this last one. This is a kind of a classic that we got here.
I'm
this
scared.
Is old.
She's
tough.
Gonna, she's her, her, her skills are eroding.
We apologize in advance for any errors.
It's true.
Now this is Old Tub Kentucky Straight Bourbon Whiskey. This is a 140-year-old brand. It was one of the first whiskeys ever made by the Beam family again, and then it went away basically. Okay. And then they just brought it back, the Old Tub label. This is a bottled in bond whiskey. I don't know if you guys are familiar with bottled in bond. There's a couple of rules there. It's got to be a single distilled season at one distillery, aged in a federally bonded warehouse for at least 4 years, and bottled at exactly 100 proof. That's the Bottled in Bond Act of 1897 stipulates that. And the only place you can get bottled in bond whiskey is America. Nobody else does it.
Really?
America. Ooh. Yeah. Now, what
this
I'm going to suggest,
very sweet and caramely.
I would try this neat, but then I would throw an ice cube in it right after that. Try it neat. You know, let's get in there. We go. This is unfiltered. Mm. This is about as close to thieving from the barrel as you're going to get. It's not carbon or chill filtered, and it basically they just take out little bits of barrel wood that's in there. But other than that, you're getting what's coming out of the barrel here.
This is delicious. It smells very sweet and caramely, but it's not that even remotely that sickly sweet taste when you actually taste it. It's delicious.
Wow, that is unique and nice.
I love this
a lot. It's very complex. I don't want to sound blowhardy, but there's like a lot going on with that one. That is nice.
It's really nice. Yeah, and what I like about this too is, we talk about all these whiskeys that we get. It's got a really cool bottle. I just think, especially now, I think people are probably building up their home bars during COVID. It's nice to have good looking bottles on your bar. You know, like I find myself now moving them around. I'm like, let me put this one up here. This looks better. And I like that. That just looks like something that my grandfather would have had on the breakfast table right there. I grew up Irish Catholic in Philly. So this would have been on the breakfast table. And then, you know,
that is that is nice.
This was awesome.
You want to guess these prices now?
Yeah. Well, you know, you let it slip, or not slip, but it's part of the description, that the little book, which was the second one, was part of a sort of limited series, you know.
It came in a fancy box.
And so that seemed to me to be the most expensive. They were all fantastic. The last one, Old Tub, was, I don't know, maybe it's just because it was the last one. But little book is got to be the most expensive of the group. The other three, I can't really figure out what they are. If you tell me any of these things are under $50, I'm going to say that's a sweet deal.
I'm going to tell you that you are correct on Little Book, and that is not under $50. But what I'm going to tell you for the others, that they all are under $50.
Really?
Oh. Nice. And what are the prices starting at? Is it what's the first?
The
one?
Lowest, the most inexpensive whiskey that we is the last one, Old Tub. You want to give a guess at what you can get a bottle of Old Tub for?
Wow, if it's under $30, I'm heading out.
I'm saying 38.
Brian,
30,
$23.
Wow, unbelievable. That's nice.
Yeah, $23. The next one is the Few, and I believe the Few. I didn't write this down, but I know what the price is. You want to take a guess on that?
Well, since our range is kind of 23, 25 to 40, I'll go 41.
$39.99.
37.
Yeah, it's about $40 a bottle, the Few. Yeah, $40. I mean, that's just great, you know, for that kind of whiskey. And then what else? Then we got the
Stranahan's.
Right.
What do you think that, and everybody loved the Stranahan's. What do you think that one cost? Small craft distillery, Colorado.
Oh, just spit it out. It's $38 or something.
$43 for the Stranahan's. And
that's
then,
nice.
Yeah, $43 for that's great. And then when you go to the Little Book, we're jumping way up to $125 a bottle.
Nice. Whoa! But you are getting your money's worth.
Presentation sharp, comes in a box.
It's a nice price, and it's limited edition. This is going to be the only year you're ever going to be able to get this. Once this whiskey's gone, it's gone. So that's $125 for that one. But you could do all of these whiskeys. You could have all of these whiskeys in your collection for around $250 for all four of those. That's not bad.
All right, the podcast, What We're Drinking with Dan Dunn, latest guest John Legend, Jason Aldean, and Pitbull, by the
Pitbull, way. Pitbull, baby, was on the show, yeah.
A lot of range there, and Lars Ulrich and Christy Brinkley coming up. That's a good, you got a good booker.
Oh, my God, Christy.
Yeah.
I blush. I interviewed her in Las Vegas a couple of years ago. I did a video with her, and it's really embarrassing to watch it because she made a comment about us hanging out on the beach, like together, her in a bikini and me. And I just literally turned red, like instantly turned red. Every childhood fantasy I'd ever had just hit me in that moment when she talked about us laying on the beach together. And I was like, like I am right now. See, I'm turning red right now.
You are very red.
Just thinking about Christy Brinkley, I'm sweating. Look.
All right, Dan, I'll let you take a cold shower. What We're Drinking with Dan Dunn. Thank you so much, Dan. We'll take a quick break. We'll come
back
with the news right after this.
Give me the news with Grad. News with Gino Grad. Breaking viral. All those crazy Trump tweets. Give me news with Gina Grad. Trouble in the Middle East. Celebrity drunk meltdowns. Need news with Gina Grad.
The news with Gina Grad.
And quick production note, I'm sure that Mike and Rich Banks are on it, and I doubt the crazy Trump tweets will stop, but we may have to update the song again, our third update. In so many years with possibly a third president.
I think we'll say some crazy Trump tweets in the near future.
I'm sure that can stay, but I'm sure Biden said enough insane stuff like he was running for Senate. So, Adam, remember the other day we talked about Breonna Taylor's boyfriend and a lot of that stuff that is not getting mainstream coverage. Very, very interesting. And just a sort of a caveat to that story.
The good boyfriend or the bad boyfriend?
The bad boyfriend.
Yes, that's the bad boyfriend.
That's who we talked about.
Well, you know, I'll tell you, we've kind of lost it in the sense that all the news focus all we talk about is the cops or the judge with the no-knock warrant or Breonna Taylor or the DA or the grand jury. We really should carve out a little conversation for the piece of shit that was her drug-dealing boyfriend, murderous boyfriend, who sort of caused all of this. You know, we wouldn't be here without him.
Right.
And I'm a very, you guys know, my whole thing is like, if that guy wasn't born, she'd be alive. And a lot of people do a lot of like, yeah, but the cops. And I'm like, that's true. But if that guy wasn't born, then she'd still be alive. And I'm a very kind of brass tacks with that shit. And I hate that our society has essentially shifted to the point where the murderous piece of shit drug addict or drug dealing boyfriend gets kind of a pass through media. Media's got no time for him, and we have all the time in the world for the cop and the judges who are in a way sucked into this thing and kind of became victims as well when you look at the real circumstances.
Yeah. Well, that is absolutely how one of the cops feels. And so one of the Louisville officers involved in the raid that led to the death of Breonna Taylor is suing her boyfriend, the one that was with her at the time, for emotional distress, assault, and battery. Sergeant Jonathan Mattingly filed a civil suit against Kenneth Walker, who shot him in the leg during the raid. Walker explains that he opened fire in self-defense when he thought there was an intruder breaking into the apartment. Mattingly was wounded in the leg and claims in his civil suit that he suffered trauma, mental anguish, emotional distress. Walker was initially arrested, but later had all the charges dismissed as it was determined he was protected under Kentucky Stand Your Ground law. Well, now the cop is going after him civilly.
It's weird when you get shot in the leg by a guy named Walker, number one. Also, when you get shot in the leg and you're doing the Stand Your Ground, it's also another irony of this case.
Right.
But now, as Mike August would say, I'm guessing that guy, the good boyfriend who shot him in the leg, is kind of an empty bag. I don't imagine they'd be living in that apartment complex if he was Daddy Warbucks. Right. Mm-hmm. And I'm not sure what this cop is doing by this.
It's optics because his life has been sort of ruined with, you know, social media?
Yeah. I mean, the cops, Imagine if you're that cop. You're just a cop. You know what I mean? Like, you make, I don't know, $65,000 a year and you're a cop, and some you're going to work and they're like, hey, there's a warrant. You got to go there at 2 a.m. Like, okay. You just show up, and the next thing you know, like, LeBron James is explaining that you should be locked up and stuff like that. I mean, just life ruining shit, right? Like, you just have the social media storm of what? And you're like, we banged on the door. We busted the door open. I got shot. I returned fire. And now LeBron James wants me electrocuted. Like, how that is pretty life altering.
That's what I, right when I heard the story before, I got into the chunk of it, that's what I figured this was about. But it's actually about, at least what he's suing for is the actual shooting. But I would imagine that there's a lot behind that. I would think.
You would rather take a bullet to the thigh than have LeBron James turn on you. That's sure. That's what my grandpappy used to say, right?
Wise words.
Yeah, it's still, I don't know, this seems solely symbolic. It doesn't seem like there's any way to get paid or anything. But yes, maybe there's, I don't know, maybe it's just that kind of thing where, like, when, your crazy ex-wife takes out a restraining order on you and you just take one out on her, like, you just go, fuck it.
Countersue, right. Yeah. Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, we mentioned the other day that France is locking back down. Germany's locking back down, although I think schools are staying open. Disneyland, Paris, that's getting locked down. Now we have two more countries to add to the mix. Austria announced on Saturday a partial shutdown. Restaurants and bars will be closed for 4 weeks. Cultural stuff, sports, leisure activities. Residents have to stay home after 8 p.m., so another curfew. And Chancellor Sebastian Kurz says the restriction will apply from Tuesday until the end of November. and Boris Johnson getting on board as well for the UK. He announced also Saturday a new month-long lockdown for England after being warned that without tough action, a resurgent coronavirus outbreak will overwhelm the hospitals in weeks. And under their restriction, bars and restaurants can only offer takeout. Non-essential shops must close. People will only be able to leave home for a short list of reasons. But unlike the UK the first time, schools, universities, construction sites, and manufacturing businesses will stay open.
Seems like kids, young people, are pretty fucking cool with this shit. Like, doesn't seem to... I was thinking about it. I was watching college football, and they're like, the Clemson quarterback's got it. And then I was watching Cam Newton and stuff.
I was thinking
about all the NFL guys and the college guys, like, they got it and then they took a week off essentially and they just came back and played. Like, I mean, if you can play quarterback at the NFL level and have had the thing 11 days ago, it's not doing anything to young people.
Justin Turner didn't know he had it.
He didn't know he had it.
The World Series.
Now he's in trouble. We'll see. We'll see what happened. The pussy sports columnist for the LA Times is like, he marred the World Series. What a fucking pussy.
When do sports guys
turn into pussies? When do sports guys get politically correct? Like, sports guys, when I was growing up, it was like Oscar Madison, like smoking a cigar, chomping on a cigar, smacking a waitress in the ass, having another highball. When did sports guys become politically correct fucking pussies? When did that fucking happen? And how fucking sad is that? Sorry.
You had mentioned something on the show the other day, and we didn't follow up with it, or I didn't, but I'm very curious because I wanted to bring it up so bad on the Conway show, but I didn't have anyone to attribute to because you kind of said it in passing. You had made a comment when we were talking about Justin Turner that they actually may have found out way earlier in the game and kind of sat on it. Do you have any recollection of saying that?
The scuttlebutt was that they found out in like the second inning, but he won out there, not like that seventh or eighth inning. That's the story I heard.
Okay. I wanted to look into that and mention it, but I thought, I don't have anyone to attribute it to. I'll skip it. But that's very interesting to me.
Right. He'll be fine. Like all the young, healthy, strong guys.
Well, that's the point. They knew that and they didn't want to lose him. So they waited as long as they possibly could.
If everyone on the Dodgers roster became positive to COVID-19, nothing would happen to anyone on the roster.
Right.
They'd all be fine. So fuck it. That's my point.
Yeah. Good point. So a couple more little COVID stories of note. And it's so funny the way this stuff is presented. I mean, this is supposed to be a big travesty in Michigan. We should be so lucky in California. So diners in Michigan will be required to give their name and phone number to restaurants and bars starting Monday in an effort to contain a recent surge over there. And I imagine that's for contact tracing, so you can get a hold of anyone that's been in the establishment. The new rule was placed by Michigan Department of Health and Human Services and also includes limiting indoor gatherings without fixed seating, like restaurants, to just 50 people. And individual tables 50. To just six
it's
people at the table.
Oh,
can you imagine? I mean, oh, you poor things. We haven't been inside of a restaurant in 8 months.
I'm dying to feel the fucking feel of red Naga hide on my ass cheeks. My ass cheeks have never missed Naga hide more. Yeah,
you can only sit six people at a table.
I was talking to Dr. Drew, who had to go to New York to do Teen Mom. And he had to go there and quarantine for like a week. And then they test everybody. Mm-hmm. And then everyone has to wear the whatever mask when they're in the building. And he was saying to me yesterday, everyone's been tested. Everyone's clean. Why do we have to wear the mask in the building? And I'm like, because people make rules like rules. And he's like, yeah, but it doesn't make sense. I'm like, that's the beauty of it. You're in charge when your rules don't make sense. Mm. That's essentially the parent going, because I said so.
Right.
That's when you're really large and in charge, when your shit doesn't make sense and you have to do it anyway. All right.
Well, you're going to love the next story, then.
Oh, good. Let me hit J.B. Weld, and then we'll do the next story. J.B. Weld, proud sponsor of our show. Great American Adhesives and Glue Company, proudly manufactured in the USA since 1969. JB Weld can fix just about anything. I've used their products around my house. I've used it in the garage. I use it for years. I was using their super weld. There's like super glue just the other day over the weekend. JB Weld is investing in America too. Just 2 years ago, they built a new state-of-the-art factory in Texas. They're hiring, they're creating jobs, they're expanding across the U.S. This is a great company. I know these guys personally. And if you're doing the DIY stuff, and I suggest you do the DIY stuff, you got to go with JB Weld. Available at jbweld.com, Home Depot, Lowe's, AutoZone, Advance Auto Parts, O'Reilly, Walmart, Amazon, Michaels, and more. Don't glue it, you JB Weld it. Okay, Gina, what else we got?
Well, speaking of how you know you're in charge, our governor here, Governor Gavin Newsom, said Friday his children have returned to in-person learning under a phased-in approach, as many schools across the state remain shuttered. And by the way, when I say many schools across the state, his public school district is still not open, and what, they don't know when they're going to open it. Hmm. That is San, you might have to help me, Brian. That's Sacramento County. Oh. And that has a, I thought it was a farther up. That has a hybrid schedule that alternates remote and in-person education before it'll go full-time next month. But according to Politico, it's not naming the school, you know, for privacy reasons and because they're kids. Sacramento County schools are allowed to open classrooms under Newsom's reopening system, but the county's large public school district, including San Juan Unified, which is where Newsom serves, that's his neighborhood, they're not allowed to open.
I talked to Sonny the other day, and I said, what's the schedule like this week or a couple days ago? And I was like, you got school this week or whatever? And he's like, they're doing Zoom, whatever. And he said, we don't have school on Friday. And I said, why not? What's Friday? And he's like, well, the teachers are using that day to grade papers. And I'm like, I think teachers fucking hate work, but like getting paid. This is the most diabolical plan in the world. We just fucking keep getting paid. They're fucking mobbed up. They're big time unions. They're in with the fucking governor. They're in with the fucking mayor. They're in with all these people. They're fucking cowards. They don't want to go back to work. They want to get paid. And there's no danger. There's no danger for the fucking kids. There isn't. This is insane. It's child abuse. My kids are fine. But what about the fucking inner city kids or the latchkey kids or the, you know, mom's got to work all day at the supermarket kids? It's fucked up. What the fuck is going on? Open the fucking schools. They're fine. The kids are fucking fine. It doesn't do anything to them. We have schools open all over the world. Where's the fucking outbreak? Where's the data? Can we follow the fucking science? Remember, we're supposed to follow the science, right? Follow the science. Follow the science, you fucking bloviated jackoffs. Good. We'll follow the fucking science that the world is telling us. Now open the fucking schools. We just have to wait till after the election. That's how it works. It's fucking nuts.
Everything God, magically open up next week.
Newsom's such a fucking hack. I can't believe he's in charge of this fucking place. Open the fucking schools. You're hurting the kids. Their chances of being harmed by coronavirus. And by the way, if you're a fucking teacher and you're fucking pussy and you don't want to fucking go in and do your job, then fucking stay home. Open the schools and you fucking stay home. The abuse, there's tons of fucking abuse going on now. These kids are getting fucked up. There's parts of their brain that are supposed to be developing now that aren't developing. Open the fucking schools. It's causing more trouble than it's saving. It's not hurting anybody. Anyone turn on the news and found out a fucking 9-year-old has died of COVID? Ever heard of it? Believe me, if it did happen, CNN would dedicate 7 days to it. Does anyone remember that story on CNN about the fucking 13-year-old that went to school and died? No?
No, I can't.
Well, then fucking open the schools. Who's working on this? Who are the experts? Who's your panel? Who's fucking in charge? It's fucking nuts. And the biggest problem are the fucking pussies who just lay around. They don't say shit about it. They're fucking scared. They're cowards. You people need to fucking speak up. It's driving me nuts. This whole fucking state is like, well, we voted for the retarded guy, so we can't really say anything. Go ahead and say something. Thank you.
Yeah, I have friends with school-age kids, and like it's they're verbalizing now how impossible it is and how much stress is putting on their family. I can only imagine for everyone.
Yeah. All right, Gina, let's bring it home.
I popped a vein
in my forehead.
Well, you know what? Let me just say this real quick. Well, instead of this being a news story, I'll just give it as a piece of trivia because I think you'll like it, and especially Brian. An odds maker in England believes that the 2020 election is the most bet on event in history. With a staggering $260 million in wagers so far. That's more than the Super Bowl, Kentucky Derby, NBA Finals, and Mayweather-McGregor put together. And the bet activity is going to increase in the days to come. So I wanted to say that now so we can watch it tomorrow as well. All right. I'm Gina Grad, and that's the news.
Gina Grad.
That was the news with Gina Grad.
Well, last but not least, a quick Simply Safe. No one should feel unsafe at home, period. And that's why Simply Safe is in the house. Get it? Protect your home today. Get free shipping at simplysafe.com/Adam. West Palm Beach Improv, November 20th and 21st. Live shows and stand up there as well. Go to adamcarolla.com for all that you need. I want to thank Mike Murphy and Dan Dunn. And until next time, this is Adam Carolla for Gina and Bald Mike and Dan saying mahalo.